So we talked about stars. We talked about stars being born. Okay, remember that we compared the life cycle of a star to the life cycle of a human. So we talk about birth and growing older and things like that. So my name's Lainey Vigneswaran. I'm in my third year of teaching, and I'm a year 11 coordinator at Northcote. So for this particular little topic, for the life cycle of a star, it started not so much with that title. It started off with me asking the students at the beginning of the year. I said to them, you know, we have curriculum that we will work through, and then there'll be some time for us to look at what you guys are interested in. I asked them broadly what topics they wanted to learn about, and then space came up quite a bit. And so what came up was things like, are black holes real? Can you survive if you go into a black hole? What's a supernova? Will our sun explode and are we going to die soon? All of these questions that were really interesting questions, and I could tell that that meant that they were firstly very curious and very much engaged in wanting to learn about that stuff, but also there were a lot of misconceptions that I thought this would be a great chance to actually get stuck into. What I would like us to do before we move on though is to put down some of those ideas that at the moment are probably just ideas onto paper, and to really try and consolidate them into good, clear scientific statements. And what's really nice as we're going is when students realise that their question is being answered. So all those students who, you know, I didn't necessarily say the word supernova at the start, but when it came up you could see that they were like, oh, that's what I was asking about. And so they see not only the answer to their question, but also where it fits into the broader topic of space and of stars. So the introduction was really just giving them a chance to have a quick flick through their notes. I find that's really helpful for increasing their confidence. If you just say, what did we learn yesterday? Even those students who do remember things just don't quite have the confidence they need to say anything. So I give them a couple of minutes to have a quick flick through their notes, and then we start just a really broad discussion. And then I wanted to give them a chance to really consolidate some of those early terms that we learnt about yesterday. Very simple activity where they had the definitions or the descriptions and then the words that they had to fill in the blanks with. And I wanted to give them a chance for the first couple of minutes to do it by themselves. They remember so much more than they think they do, and so 2 minutes to 3 minutes on their own, and then a chance to check with the person next to them. What's really important for you guys to take away from this little activity is not just being able to look at the sentence and then label the word, but actually also being able to produce that kind of sentence or description or definition using all of those terms, all of that scientific terminology. Yesterday was very practical. We had different sized balls, and we had students standing in the middle and others rotating around and doing lots and lots of talking and physical movement, which was really, really fun, but didn't necessarily allow for consolidation of ideas and didn't necessarily allow for me to assess how they were going. This one is going to be a little bit tricky as well, so it's really important that you have a look at this resource. Okay, so have a look at the words that are written into this flowchart. Okay, so you have to try and match up the descriptions that are here to these diagrams. That might help you a little bit with this one. Okay. The third activity was them using the exact same knowledge, but this time applying it quite differently. Rather than looking at wordy descriptions, they were looking at diagrams, which I purposefully chose ones, some of which are very clear, and some that were a little bit confusing and could be, you know, confused for other things. Between question two and three, it's actually the same knowledge, but you're just applying it in different ways. The plan that I had was to show them what their misconception was, maybe even where it came from, and how it could be addressed. Okay, so
Is the proto-star, because it still doesn't think it's all being pulled together.
Okay, so this is a really good example of where these diagrams can be a little bit confusing. This is actually showing you a proto-star that is forming in a nebula. This is a more distinct pattern. This is showing later stages when the outer parts of a star have burnt out, and so they've become gone back to being gas and dust, and they're leaving the body of the star. It's actually the other way around. Okay? And that activity was just focusing on low mass stars. So the next activity after that was for them to identify what the differences were between low and high mass. They had resources from yesterday, so I was directing them to that because I wanted them to refer to that information. That was really all about scaffolding them all the way through to them finally filling in those blanks. Now that they know what the stages are and that a low mass star isn't going to become a supernova, our sun won't become a supernova when it explodes and that sort of stuff, then I felt that that was a good platform for them to go and look into what actually happens. So what happens when hydrogen finishes fusing? What happens to the helium? Those questions, or at least the resources that they will use to learn about that on the internet, that'll be a lot easier to understand when they know where it fits into the framework. This, so far, was just to get you guys acquainted with the steps setting up for me. Just the steps, the different stages of the life cycle of the star. We haven't really gone into much detail about what actually happens in each stage of the life cycle of a star. And that's when, at this stage, I'm going to hand over to you guys. You're going to be doing a little bit of independent work. And by independent, I mean I'm not going to be telling you these facts. I think that's going to end up being really boring. You're going to come up with some information on your own. The stages of the life cycle that we've talked about so far, they're the same for any star. Beyond the stages that we've talked about, it differs a bit for the smaller stars and for the larger stars. And this is where you guys are going to fill in the rest of these blanks. You're going to fill in the rest of the story about what happens to different sized stars. You may use your notes, you may use the internet, you may work with the person next to you or the people next to you, up to you. What they were doing previously wasn't them constructing their own knowledge, that was them. It was the lower levels of Bloom taxonomy that was required, but I'll be looking at their construction of knowledge when they hand this work in to really see, to give them really detailed feedback. And I'll do that in a written format, so they'll get notes on a little, they've got a pro forma for assessment feedback they get from me, I'll make some notes, but I'll also talk to them as I'm handing it back to them as well, and then give them time to ask me questions if they're not sure about the feedback that I've given them.